I just want to read, us to read the book of John chapter 14 verse 12, where the Lord was saying, he says, he that believeth in me, the works that I do, he will do. That's in the book of John chapter 14 verse 12. He says, he that believeth in me, the works that I do, the same works he will do. And now added, he said, greater works than this shall he do, because I go unto the Father. You know, he promised, or he said he will go unto the Father, that when he goes to the Father, he will send the promise of the Holy Spirit unto us. So he said, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, the person will do also, but greater works than this. That means the Lord Jesus Christ himself has already earmarked that we're going to do much more than he even did when he was on the planet Earth here, because by that time, the Holy Spirit had not been given, but by the time he was going, he left us with the promise that the Holy Spirit will come upon us. And when the Holy Spirit came in the day of Pentecost, that day marks the day man, Christians, enter into the realm of possibilities in the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So, but when the Lord was saying, the works that I do, you will do, and that greater works than this you will do. What are those works that the Lord was referring to? Because I want us to really understand it. If we understand exactly what works the Lord was doing when he was here on the planet Earth, and the same work he has already delegated unto us, we'll know exactly our realm of operation on this planet Earth. We'll know exactly what we are fighting for. We'll know exactly what we are key into. We'll know exactly what our daily activities ought to do, ought to be in advancing the kingdom of God. Praise the Lord. So please, if you can just open your Bibles to the book of Isaiah chapter 61, I'm going to read out unto us something that will open our eyes also. Isaiah chapter 61, I'll start from verse 1. We're talking of what are the works that the Lord did. So here in the book of Isaiah chapter 61, starting from verse 1, it says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed and commissioned me. I'm reading from Amplified Version. He said, because the Lord has anointed and commissioned me to bring good news to the humble and afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted and to proclaim release, that is, from confinement and condemnation to the physical and spiritual captives, that is, those groups that are already bound, and to proclaim the favorable years of the Lord. Praise the Lord. So this statement of the Lord are actually in the book of Isaiah chapter 61 from verses 1 to 3. I call them messianic assignments. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. That means God, his Father, has anointed and commissioned him for all these purposes, for all these assignments that is listed in the book of Isaiah chapter 61 verses 1 to 3. He says, he has anointed me to proclaim, to preach the good news. You know, when you look at all these statements, all what I call the messianic assignment here, they are actually categorized into all the things that the Lord Jesus Christ did when he was on the planet Earth here. And I will just mention one or two or three of them. The first one, right there, it says, has to do with salvation of soul. That's one of the primary reasons why the Lord himself came to this world. That means if he was saving souls, he expects us to save more souls than he did when he was there on planet Earth. So that one is found in that book when he said, because the Lord has anointed and commissioned me to bring good news to the humble and afflicted. And we know that the good news is the gospel of salvation. Hallelujah. The next one is healing. I will find that one in the book in the second part of that verse. It says, he has sent me to bind up. And Jewish Bible says, he has sent me to heal up the wounds of the brokenhearted. That means the Lord Jesus Christ came to heal us physically and spiritually. So I call all these things that the Lord did messianic assignments. Hallelujah. So the next one is deliverance, and that one is found itself to proclaim release from confinement and condemnation to the physical and spiritual captives. That means there are people that are actually bound physically and bound spiritually. So he said he came to set them free and to proclaim liberty unto them. That's one of the messianic assignments, which already delegated unto us, even as a church also, that is to bring deliverance to the world. Hallelujah. And the next one is to bring full comfort and hope to the dying nations. You know, the Bible said that the whole world lies in fear and in darkness. It said, darkness will cover the earth and gross darkness the people. But the Lord Jesus Christ said, he said, he came to set the captives free, you know, to bring comfort and hope to the dying world. Praise the Lord. And the Bible says in the book of Matthew 11, 20, it says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. So these are what I call messianic assignments, which the Lord did when he was there. That was made, and that's the main reason why he came to this world. He said, the Lord God has anointed me for these particular purposes. So, and he mentioned it here. Hallelujah. So that means when he was going, he also delegated this assignment to us as a church. And you will all agree with me that all these assignments that the Lord Jesus Christ himself mentioned in this book of Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 to 3 to 4, is their assignment that cannot be carried out with human understanding. The assignment that cannot be carried out with human wisdom. The assignment that cannot be carried out with power and might. The Bible says in the book of Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6, it said, not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Hallelujah. That means when we now key into the power of the Holy Spirit, there's no limit to what we can do as individuals, as families, but especially as a church, into advancing the kingdom of God and doing unlimited, carried out unlimited possibilities. Hallelujah. I said, okay, the next question now is, what is the ultimate purpose of this messianic assignment? What is the ultimate purpose of the messianic assignment that I already mentioned in the book of Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 to 3? The main purpose of the messianic assignment is for kingdom advancement. Nothing more, nothing else. It's for kingdom advancement. And what is kingdom advancement? Kingdom advancement are every scriptural principle or strategies. Every scriptural principle or strategy that is designed to enthrone Christ, first of all, in the heart of men, that's what we call salvation. First of all, it has to be installed in the heart of men. That's what we call salvation. And again, in every strata of human endeavor. And that is what we call righteousness. The Bible says that the kingdom of God is not in meat and drink, but in righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Righteousness, that means doing things God's way. We are not talking about the type of the righteousness that came upon us when we gave our life to Christ, that is the righteousness that comes unto us by the Lord Jesus Christ. We are talking of the will of God being done on earth as it is done in heaven. Hallelujah. So I said, the Lord himself, when teaching the disciples in the book of Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 to 10, when he came unto me and he said, oh Lord, teach us how to pray. You know, after starting from the first verse, when he said, okay, you should pray like this one, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. The next one, after praising God, he said, thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. Thy kingdom come. That means the main purpose of messianic agenda or messianic principle or messianic assignment is for kingdom advancement, to make sure that the kingdom of earth is ruled according to the principles and the dictates of heaven. Hallelujah. I said the main purpose is to establish the kingdom of God first, like I said earlier on, first of all in the heart of men, which we call salvation. And again, in every strata of human endeavor, that is to superimpose the modus operandi of heaven on planet Earth. To superimpose the modus operandi, that is the way of doing things. You know, there's so many ways we can do things in this world, and we think, oh, this is the right way to do things. No. That's one of the mistakes, that's one of the deception that the devil gave to Adam in the Garden of Eden. When he said, oh, you're going to be like God, you're going to be like this, you're going to be like God when you eat this food. He actually wanted him to establish, to be doing things in some right way. But the way we do things is not supposed to be our own way. It has to be done according to heaven's way. And that's like I said earlier on, that's what we call righteousness. That is right way of doing things. So the main reason of the messianic assignment is to superimpose the modus operandi of heaven on planet Earth. Hallelujah. So the Lord himself mandated the church to carry out, before he went to heaven, all these assignments. And like I said earlier on, you will agree with me that they are responsibilities that cannot be carried out by might nor by power. Hallelujah. The Bible says in the book of Zechariah, I've already mentioned that in Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6, it says, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord God Almighty. So here comes the role of prayer and fasting in advancing the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Here comes the role of fasting and prayer in advancing the kingdom of God. You know, the main purpose, the role of prayer here, amongst others, like I said earlier on, fasting and prayer is not just the main way or the main role strategy here. There are others like faith, diligence. You know, you have to be diligent, you have to be disciplined, you have to be, you know, steadfast in it. You have to be in and out of season, doing things in and out of season. But prayer and fasting is actually the foundation of everything. It's the foundation upon which all other things, all other strategies are built. Hallelujah. So the main agent for this preparation, that is for the equip, for this preparation that we're talking about, is the Holy Spirit. And the Lord himself promised the gift of the Holy Spirit because he knew that this assignment, this messianic assignment, which will count on the limit to some people, it is limited possibilities, or let me say, things that are impossible, because there are things that cannot be done with human wisdom. But to us, as children of God, since we have the power of the Holy Spirit, like I said earlier on, there's nothing that can hinder us from carrying out all these assignments. There are now unlimited possibilities for us as the children of God, because already we have the same power that the Lord Jesus Christ deployed when he was here on planet Earth to carry out this as messianic assignment. Praise the Lord. As I said, this is where actually prayer and fasting comes in, essentially. Praise the Lord. And I pray the Lord will strengthen us and enable us to catch, you know, all these things. So to just summarize what I've already said here, the reason Jesus Christ came to this world is to carry out some messianic assignment, which I've already explained to us in the book of Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 to 3. And again, when he was going to heaven, he delegated this responsibility unto us. And he said, okay, you guys wait in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. And on the day of Pentecost, when that Holy Spirit came upon the apostles, that power to carry out this messianic assignment was deployed to them. And since then, the church has been witnessing, you know, demonstration of the power of the Holy Spirit in so many areas of the lives of the church. Hallelujah. So I'm going to the next one. That is the role of prayer and fasting in carrying out these unlimited possibilities. What is the role? Why do we need to pray? Why do we need to engage ourselves in the principle of prayer in the first one? But before I go into some of the things I've already listed here, I just want us to understand also that even the Lord Jesus Christ himself, God, man, when he was here on earth, he didn't say, oh, because I'm God. He didn't say, because I have the full power of the Holy Spirit. He didn't say, because already I am anointed already, that I will not pray. No, he had to deploy the principle of prayer and fasting to engage in spiritual warfare, to engage in spiritual battle, to be able to superimpose the modus operandi of heaven on earth. You know, to be able to engage fully in his messianic activities as an assignment, he had to engage the principle of prayer and fasting. And if our Lord and Savior could do that, who are we then? That means if we're going to get the same results that the Lord Jesus Christ himself got, that means we have to do it the way he did it. But even what he said, greater works than this you're going to do. That means if we're going to do greater works, that means we have to take extra effort. We have to take extra full steps, you know, to engage the power of prayer and fasting, even in advancing God's kingdom. Hallelujah. So I now begin to itemize what are the roles of prayer and fasting in advancing the kingdom of God, that is in carrying out unlimited possibilities. Number one, brethren, our words are very, very powerful, and words are very creative. Words are very creative. When you pray, especially pray in the Holy Spirit, our words are energized to do great and mighty works. Our words are empowered to carry out assignments. The Bible says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. That means if we are going to speak life to somebody, that life must come from our mouth. Also, if we're going to speak death to the works of the devil, it's also going to come from our mouth also. That means, and I have it here, I said, the potency of your words that will speak is directly proportional to the potency of your spirit man. If what I have just said now is the only thing we can get from today's teaching, that's enough for us. The potency of the word we speak from our mouth is directly proportional to the potency of our spirit man. And that's why the Bible says in the book of Jude, chapter 20, it says, brethren, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Words emanate from our spirit man. Words come out from our spirit man. If the words that comes out from our spirit man is not energized, there's no way it can accomplish anything. And if your spirit man is not fully charged up, if it's not energized, the words that will come out from it will not have enough power. It don't have enough potency to do whatever word, to do whatever you are sending that word to do. Hallelujah. You know, like I said, words, because words originate from the spirit man, because the Bible says in the book of Proverbs chapter 40, verse 20, it says, guard your heart, that is your spirit man, with all jealousy, out of it are the issues of life. But the Bible again says in the book of Jude chapter 20, verse 20, it says, building up yourself in your whole most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. So I said, the weaker your spirit man, the weaker your words are going to be. But the stronger your spirit man is, the stronger your words are going to be. And that's one of the main reasons why a man of God will speak to a mountain or speak to a demon, the demon will not yield. It is because the spirit of that person is weak. The Bible says that even on the day of adversity, we fail. That means our strength is small. It's also super, it means also, if in the days of spiritual battle, we don't win, or we are overcome by the enemy, it means our spirit man is weak. But why our spirit man, why is this weak? It's because we have not engaged the principle of prayer and fasting in building up the spirit man. And that is why many of us Christians are defeated when it comes to spiritual battles, especially when a Christian sleeps and he sees what's called demons chasing him, or masquerades chasing him, or something just chasing him in his sleep. It means that person's spirit is very, very weak. I've experienced it before. So I'm not talking from, I'm talking life, I'm talking testimonies. That if your spirit man is weak, when it comes to spiritual battles, especially when you are asleep, and that's why many Christians, they wake up and they find all over their bodies, you know, marks and things like that, masquerades, you know, hitting people, something's happening to them. It's because the spirit man is weak. So like I said earlier on, the potency of the word that you speak is directly proportional to the potency of your spirit man. Like I said, brother, if this is the only thing we get from today, it will help us to know how we're going to engage in the principle of prayer and fasting to carry out unlimited possibilities. You cannot cast out devil by just mere because, oh, I know how to speak, or because I have PhD, or because, oh, I'm fully dressed, I'm properly dressed, or because, oh, I have charisma. No. Your charisma does not stand anything when it comes to spiritual battles, when it comes to warring against the kingdom of darkness. The only thing they understand is the power of the Holy Spirit. Nothing more, nothing else. Hallelujah. So the next one, like it's also, related to the first one that I said earlier on. Like I said, the potency of your word is directly proportional to the potency of your spirit man. The second one is also in line with that one. It strengthens the principle of prayer. When you deploy the principle of prayer and fasting, your spirit man is strengthened. Like I've already explained to Ross in the book of Jude, chapter 20. When the Bible talks in the book of Jude chapter 20, that is building up yourself in the most holy faith. The great men of God, many of the books that I've read and which I know personally, they said it's like likening it to charging a battery. Whether your phone battery or your car battery, the power, the appliance you're going to use, the effectiveness of that power will be determined by how strong the battery is. If your battery is weak, the appliance you're going to charge that battery with is not going to be very, very effective. So, building up your most holy spirit can be likened to when you charge a battery. So, when your spirit man is fully charged, you are able to deploy spiritual energy to wage effective spiritual war. But if our spiritual battery is not charged, our spiritual battery is not charged, there's nothing to deploy, brethren. We'll just shout. You can pray from here and pray some and shout and shout and shout and shout. Nothing is going to happen. If our, brethren, the essence here is our spirit man. Let's get it right. It's our spirit man. I'm not talking of mind. I'm not talking of your flesh. I'm talking of the spirit man. If the spirit man is weak, a weak Christian is a powerless Christian. It's not just because talking of muscles and bones and no, it's talking about the spirit man. Hallelujah. So, like I said, when a battery is weak or it's not strong enough, the appliance they are going to use or you are powering it with is not going to be very effective. And the same thing with us also. Anointing, brethren, is in measures. And like I said, we have to be fully charged if we're going to be very effective in spiritual warfare. Anointing is in measures. The only person that has the anointing with that measure is the Lord Jesus Christ. All of us, we have anointing in measures. So that means the strength of the anointing, or let me say this, the strength of the battle you're going to win in the realm of the spirit will depend on the level of the charge of the anointing that you have. The kind of anointing you will use to cast out your to heal ordinary headache, you're not going to use the same kind of anointing to heal somebody who is demon possessed. Just like the Lord Jesus Christ told his disciples, you know, when he brought a particular boy to dumb and he couldn't speak to him, and he said, we'd try to cast out. Because they had done something like that before, probably did some things and maybe lay hands, few hands on some people, and maybe cast out some weak demons. But they didn't know they were contending with a very strong demon this time around. And Jesus Christ laughed and said, yes, this one's word not out, but by fasting and prayer. He was telling them categorically that they have to engage the principle of prayer and fasting, really, for them to be able to cast out this stubborn spirit. Because that stubborn spirit has taken the control over the man's vocal cords and every other thing. He couldn't speak, he was dumb. Hallelujah. So we have to be fully anointed. If we're going to do unlimited possibility, if we're going to, yes, we can do some things here and there, heal headache, heal this one. But when it comes to strong, stubborn cases, brethren, our spirit man needs to be charged properly. And yeah, we know God is the one that answers prayers, that at the end of the day, God is the sovereign God. Sometimes when we pray, yes, God is the sovereign God. He answers prayers also. But we have to be sure, we have to know also that the power that has been given unto us, God has given us. He said, you go and do these works. Lay hands upon the sick. Cast out demons. You don't preach the gospel. He knew some things that he has deposited in us, that when we deploy these things, we're able to do much and much for him. So that means if we don't charge up our spirit man, if we don't fully engage in the principle of prayer and fasting, there's no way we can do all these things that the Lord himself asked us to do. And even if we're going to do it at all, if we're not fully charged up, our realm of possibilities will be limited. That's it. It will be limited. We won't be able to do much for Christ. I pray the Lord will grant us, understanding in everything that we're hearing tonight in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. The next one is when we deploy the principle of fasting and prayer, it opens the gateway to spiritual gifts. It opens the gateway to spiritual gifts. Brethren, there's no gainsaying, there's no, we cannot overemphasize the fact that the Bible says, it says in the book of Matthew chapter 4, 24, verse 28, it says, where the carcass is here, there the eagles will gather together. Where the carcass is here, there the eagles will gather together. If we are going to see much result in our assignment, in our messianic assignment that has been delegated unto us according to the book of Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 to 4, the church needs to be operating in the gift of the Holy Spirit. When I mean the church, all of us combined, we need to be operating in the gift of the Holy Spirit in our midst. Without the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, or the working of the Holy Spirit in our midst, brethren, and that's the basic truth. For me personally, I've told myself, if there's no way we can, if without the manifestation of the Spirit and working of the Spirit, the church will just become a social club where we just gather together, sing some songs, and sing. We're not going to be seeing people getting engaged. Delivered. We're not going to be seeing mass, people coming into the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. So it is the manifestation of the gifts and the working of the Holy Spirit that enable us to be fully effective in carrying out our messianic assignments. It is the manifestation of the Spirit of God and the working of the Spirit of God in our midst that enable us to be effective in carrying out our messianic assignment that has been delegated unto us. And this can only happen through the deployment of prayer and fasting. Hallelujah. Like I said earlier on, where the church, the carcass is here, dead eagles will gather together. And yeah, I know that there are so many churches today that we have churches where satanic powers are being deployed, people, you know, doing miracles. Yes. But again, that's not as if for us to say, oh, maybe because this some churches or so-called churches actually, they are using the devil power. We also that have the original power, we should seek after it so that we can be able to deploy that power to counteract the effect of the for the enemy. Even the last of people that they are holding in bondage. Hallelujah. So, brethren, the effectiveness of our ministry as individuals in the church in LSC would depend on how effective the working of the Spirit of God is in our individual lives. That means if I'm an usher, if I can deploy the principle of fasting and prayer very well, maximally, I will be an anointed usher and very effective. If I'm a chorister, if I can wait upon the Lord in place of prayer and fasting, I will be an effective chorister. I don't just be singing, I will be ministering. That's even when I'm ministering, some things will be happening. If I'm a prayer warrior, I'm a prayer in the department, if I can deploy the principle of fasting and prayer, I will be an effective intercessor. You know, I will see results in my ministry. Hallelujah. So, brethren, there's no guessing or there's no emphasizing the fact that we need these things to happen in our lives. We need to deploy the principle of prayer and fasting for us to be effective in our individual ministries in the church. If we're not seeing any result presently, brethren, I'm not talking about, you know, the Lord Jesus Christ didn't come to this world for us to build mansions. They are good. Or for us to enjoy life, you know, eat dog, eat good superfood and all this. I love food. A lot. I mean, but what I'm saying is that the Lord Jesus Christ did not come for those purposes. Even the children of the world, they are wiser. They are doing the things that using some principle to enjoy all these good things. So the main reason why the Lord Himself came is for kingdom advancement. Like I said earlier on, to deploy every scriptural principle or strategies to enthrone Christ in the heart of men and every starter of life. So that means if we are going to affect any of our society or even the church as a whole, we have to be operating in the gift of the Holy Spirit, and we have to see the Holy Spirit working maximally in our lives in the mighty name of Jesus. And I pray the Lord will help us in this aspect in the mighty name of Jesus, that we'll be able to see exactly why we need to give ourselves into deploying this principle. Brethren, it's not going to be easy. No, the Bible said that we should be instant in season and out of season. That is, when it is convenient, when it's not convenient, when you feel like doing it, when you don't feel like doing it, when it's at night, when your whole body is racking, well, it just starts. There's something we call an escape velocity in physics. You may be tired, but when you start, something will just take over you, and then you enter into another realm, and it goes on like that. Hallelujah. So the principle, the next one I'm going to share with us now is that's in deploying the principle of prayer and fasting is it is the foundation upon which every spiritual project is built. Prayer and fasting, like I said earlier on, is the foundation upon which every spiritual project is built. If God has given you a ministry or a vision in your life concerning anything at all, if you now say, oh, because I've already, even if you saw the Lord Jesus Christ coming into your room directly like this and showing himself and say, okay, oh, my son, you're going to be this, you're going to be that. If you just stop in that way and don't deploy the principle of prayer and fasting to be able to effect that ministry, to bring it into fruition, the ministry, the vision will not be accomplished. So we need, that's what I said, it is the foundation upon which every spiritual project is built. I just want to share one testimony that a man I read in a book of one great man of God has gone to be with the Lord now, and that is Oral Roberts. He said, "When you know, we're talking about unlimited possibilities, that is advancing the kingdom of God, that is to build the kingdom of God upon this planet." He said, the Lord called him and said, okay, my son, you're going to build a university for me. That's Oral Roberts. Admas wondered himself, Lord, build a university for you. But he didn't ask the Lord that, where am I going to get money? But he said at that time, he now called his friends and everything and said, okay, this is what the Lord told me to do, to build a university for him. And he said in his account in that day, that time, he said he had only a character, if I can remember it very well, I don't know how much now, but he said, I think something around $48. How can you ask a man that has $48 to go and build a university? That is impossible, impossible. Humanly speaking, impossible, impossible. Humanly speaking. But what the Lord told him, he didn't argue with the Lord, he didn't, but he knew exactly what to do. He said he went to the realm of prayer and fasting. You know, brethren, when the Lord gives you an assignment and you deploy the principle of prayer and fasting, the execution of that project will be seamless, effortless, without any stress. Without any stress. If we're doing anything, if we're being stressful, we should go back and check and see, this thing that I'm doing, that I believe the Lord has asked me to do, if it's going to lead me to my death or to stress or for me to have stroke, and then I begin to question it, because the gift of the Lord, it says, how do I quote it now? And okay, what I'm just trying to say is that when the Lord asks you to do something, he does not bring any evil with it. He brings pleasure, he brings goodwill, he brings peace of mind with it. So the man said, when the Lord asked him to go and build the university, he didn't argue with the Lord. He now gathered himself together and his friends, they went to the realm of prayer and fasting. And he said he locked himself up for so many days, prayer, praying and praying and praying, until his spirit mouth just opened up. And he said, yes, I've gotten it. Do you know that by the time he left that place, came out, addressed the board that I already set up that way, that moment, people that they didn't know, millions, thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars, started coming. And the Lord said, I should give you this one. And the Lord said, I should do this. And the Lord said, I should do this. And the Lord said, I should do this. You know, it is because he deployed the principle of prayer and fasting. If he had just sat back and said, the Lord asked me to build a university, well, I'm not going to do anything about this. I'm just going to see it because the Lord has said, the Lord will do it. No. It doesn't work out that way for us. It doesn't work out that way. If we're going to wait until that, we'll wait until eternity and nothing's going to happen. Praise the Lord. So for us as individuals, as families, and as a church also, whatever it is that God has asked us to do, we must engage fully in the principle of prayer and fasting for us to be effective or to see the manifestation of that thing in the realm of the physical. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Even the Lord Jesus Christ himself, before he started the ministry, he didn't say, because I'm God, or because I have the anointing, because when the Holy Spirit came upon me, the Holy Spirit came fully upon him. So he didn't say, because I had the Spirit of God without measure, I'm not going to pray. No, we find instances in the Bible where the Lord will go all night and engage himself in prayer and fasting. And in the morning, he will come and miracles and signs and wonders will be happening. And the same thing with Paul. Paul, when he was converted, the first 3 days, he used it in prayer and fasting. Although he was forced to engage in the principle of fasting and praying, until the third day, when someone came to lay hands upon him, for him to release the baptism of the Holy Spirit and for his eyes to be opened. But he said even later on that he had to go to the Arabia, you know, to prepare himself. And Bible scholars said that during those periods, he was actually studying and waiting, praying and fasting, until most of the books and every revelation that he now shared in the books, in the Testament, all those revelations, he said he got them directly from the Lord, not from any soul, not from Peter or any of the apostles. No, he got everything directly from a revelation from God. And that is by deploying the principle of prayer and fasting. I pray the Lord will help us in this aspect in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Another one, one of the main reasons for us also to engage the principle of prayer and fasting, you know, for unlimited possibilities, is for us to enforce the kingdom of God on earth. For us to enforce the kingdom of God on earth. The Bible says in the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 12, it said, from the days of John the Baptist. I'm going to read that one for us, please. The book of Matthew. Let me just open it to read. The book of Matthew. Hallelujah. Chapter 11. I'll read verse 12. Matthew chapter 11, verse 12. It says, from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of God suffers violent assaults. You know, the kingdom of God suffers violent assaults. Brethren, there is any generation where the enemy is engaging in full onslaught and assault against the kingdom of God. It is now. It is now. There are alignments now in the realm of the spirit. I know we all, I mean, by the grace of God, we all read news here and there, where nations are gathering together now, the alliances all over the whole place, you know, nations making alliance with one another. All of these things are happening as a result of sort of demonic manipulation, you know, to lay assaults and siege upon the kingdom of God. It says from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of God suffered violent assaults and violent men seizing by force. If we are going to repel that violent assault of the enemy, we also need to be violent also. That is, we as Christians, we need to be violent. And that is why we need to have prayer meetings where all night, you know, just praying in the spirit, violently against every satanic attack or against every satanic agenda. I mean, by the grace of God, there was a time, was it shortly around March or April this year? I don't know, maybe I hearkened to the word of the Lord, or maybe I didn't, maybe because of laziness, or because of labor. There was a time at the place of work, when I was just patrolling around at my place of work, the Lord was ministering to me that we should pray against satanic agenda. I didn't know exactly what, maybe it came strongly, but now we are seeing exactly satanic agenda. There are those activities, demonic activities, that are being brought together for the planned enthronement of satanic kingdom upon this planet. You know, to subvert the kingdom of God and impose his own kingdom upon this planet Earth. So that means if we're going to enforce the kingdom of God upon this planet Earth, brethren, we need to engage fully in the principle of prayer and fasting. Like I said, you will agree with me, there's satanic assault on anything that is associated with the Lord. And his main aim is to take full control of the planet Earth and set up his own kingdom. So one of the roles of fasting and prayer is to enforce God's kingdom upon this earth. The Bible says that we do not war against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, and against wicked spirits in the realm of the heavens, in the heavenly places. You know, this principle, this heavenly, these satanic forces, they are there as satanic agents, you know, to wage war against the children of God and to wage war against this planet Earth. And the Bible is also saying in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 4, it says, both weapons of warfare, they are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. Hallelujah. So we find out that we're not deploying human effort, we're not deploying human strategies or human weapons, maybe our understanding, maybe our wisdom, or maybe because I've read the whole Bible from back to back, or maybe because I have PhD in this or PhD in that, or maybe because I'm like, no. All those things, like I said earlier on, the devil does not recognize all those things. The only ones he recognizes is the one you come face to face with the power of the Holy Spirit, or with the blood of Lord Jesus Christ, or with the name. But like I said earlier on, if we are going to be very effective, our spirit man needs to be up completely, fully. And like I said, the potency of our energy, of our power, will depend on the potency of our spirit man. Hallelujah. And then lastly, the last one I'm going to share with us is the role of fasting and prayer, you know, even in carrying out unlimited possibility. And you know, brethren, if you all agree with me, the flesh, Bible says that the flesh profits nothing. The flesh does not want us to do anything good in life. The flesh does not want us to carry out the plans of God for this earth. The flesh of God does not want us to even fast, to even pray, not to talk of even praying. So that means if we are going to be fully effective to be able to carry out unlimited possibilities, we have to deal first of all with our flesh. We have to subdue the flesh. We have to superimpose the power of our spirit upon that of the flesh. And that is why prayer and fasting also comes in. You know, when we pray and fast also, especially the issue of fasting, we're not just praying also for our spirit man to be built up. We're praying that our flesh will be subdued so that the spirit man inside of us can be enthroned, can come alive and be fully energized. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible says that the spirit warreth against the flesh, and the flesh against the spirit, because the flesh knows that once he has dominion over the spirit man, there's no way the flesh is always antagonistic of God. It's always antagonistic. So you need to deploy the principle of fasting, especially fasting also. If you know that there's anything in our lives, maybe there's one weakness, or maybe we have one Achilles heel or the other in our lives that's still preventing us from fully being used by God, if we can engage the principle of prayer and fasting also, especially when with focus, the Lord can deal with such things in our lives and liberate our spirit man to be fully effective in carrying out our messianic assignment. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So, brethren, this is what I have to share with us today. But like I said earlier on, there's one thing I just want us, I want to leave with us, and I want us to remember very well today, especially where we as Christians, is that when it comes to doing unlimited possibilities for God, our spirit man, we're not talking about building houses or building cars or buying mansions or having, no, we're not talking about those things. We're talking about the scriptural strategies and principles to enthrone the kingdom of God in the heart of men and in every strata of human endeavor. This can only be done through effectiveness of our spirit man. And if our spirit man is not effective, there's no way we can be effective in the work of the Lord. That's just the main thing, the crux of what I have to share with us today. That is, like I said earlier on, the potency of what of the word of a spirit man will depend on how strong your spirit man is. And the Bible says, the book of Jude, it says, brethren, building up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. I pray the Lord will send us, even as individuals, as a church, and as families, that the grace to be able to engage fully in this principle of prayer and fasting, that the Lord will, God Almighty will pour it upon us. You know, that anointing, the spirit of prayer and the spirit of supplication will come upon us as individuals and as a church, that we will not be weary, will not be tired in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That everything that Lord we need to do, Heavenly Father, Lord, to carry out this messianic assignment, Heavenly Father, Lord, grant unto us, oh God, even as a church, my Lord, my God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Now, Father, all those things, oh God, Lord, you said your word, you said the works that you do, we will do. And greater works than this shall we do, because you go unto your Father. Because you said when you go to the Father, you send the Holy Spirit unto us. Father, Lord Jesus Christ, when you left for this planet, you promised us with us the gift of the Holy Spirit, and that same Holy Spirit has come upon us. Lord, help us, oh God, to deploy, oh God, this power, Heavenly Father, to the maximum use, Heavenly Father, to enthrone your kingdom, Heavenly Father, to enthrone, Heavenly Father, your kingdom, Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. My son, the Libra, can him assume to their so hand up, my son, the Libra, had my young lady. Lord, we ask, oh God, Lord, even as a church, Heavenly Father, you sending us, oh God, that Lord, we might be effective, oh God, in our ministry, my Father, my God, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Father, every attempt of the enemy, Heavenly Father, Lord, to make us to be weary or to be weak, Heavenly Father, Lord, we come against it, my Father, my God, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, Lord, tonight, Heavenly Father, we key in, oh God, even as a church, Heavenly Father, to that, oh God, Father, Lord, unlimited Lord, power, Lord, which is the power of the Holy Spirit. We key in into it, my God, and my God, and Father, Lord, we will not be disconnected from it, my Father, my God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Now, Father, whatever, oh God, that might be in our lives, Heavenly Father, individually, even as a church, Heavenly Father, that will not allow us, Heavenly Father, to deploy, oh God, even these principles, Heavenly Father, not destroy completely, my Father, my God, in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, enthrone, oh God, Christ over our hearts, enthrone, oh God, Christ over our church, Heavenly Father, let the church, oh God, advance, Heavenly Father, even in this nation, Heavenly Father, in this land, Heavenly Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, and let the name and reign alone be glorified. Blessed be your holy name, Father, my God. In Jesus' precious name, we have prayed. Amen.